give a little bit of a seminar on salmon fishing. Pacific salmon, which entails quite a few species. What we're going to talk about tonight mainly is coho, or silver salmon as they're commonly called, and king salmon, commonly called Chinook or Tai, a number of other names. That's the two species that we're going to talk about. That's what we fish for here. I think we've all attended a lot of seminars, and usually when you go to a seminar, they're limited to 30 minutes on the stage. They get out a rod and a reel and little mooching gear and say, this is how you do it, to drop it down and hope you hook a fish. I believe that you have to know your enemy before you can face them. So I kind of like to know a little about the salmon before I start searching and trying to catch them. That's the part I'm going to talk about, and then Gene is going to give a little bit about the artillery we use to catch them with, both being equally important, I believe. The Pacific salmon range all the way from Baja California all the way up into the Straits, Alaska, Bering Sea, all the way into Japan. Japan and Russia have wiped out their salmon. They've overfished them, overpolluted them, and over I don't give a damn. So they have no more salmon. They're moving down off our coast, midwater, deep water trawl, midwater trawl nets. They're taking our salmon because they've overfished their own. If we're not careful, keep them out of here and do a little more conservation, then we won't have any. We'll go into that a little bit later. Right now, the salmon that we fish for, being the king salmon and the Chinook salmon, the king salmon and the silver salmon, our primary fishery is out of the Sacramento River. Salmon are migratory. They go up the river to spawn. Just to kind of an overview of the cycle, they'll spawn in the Sacramento River system and the tributaries of the Sacramento. They'll spawn, and after the first year, they will come back to the ocean. They'll live in the ocean for 2 to 3 years, the king salmon. After the third year to the fourth year, they start moving back in to the river system to spawn again. Spawn and they die. They don't come back again, but they're cycle again. The silver salmon, being the smaller of the two, when they go up, they are a 2 to 3 year fish. They have the same cycle. They're spawned in the same grounds up the river, but they return in 2 to 3 years. And then they die and they're young coming back. So, the fish that we get in the ocean, the most of them are 2 to 3 year fish. The silvers and 3 to 4 year fish to the king or Chinook salmon. The salmon that we catch in this area, like I say, are most of them come from the Sacramento River Delta area. Most of them today are artificially spawned. They're not natural spawned. They're mostly artificial spawned fish. They move out to the ocean, and even the learned people don't know exactly where they spend this 2 to 3, 4 years that they're in the ocean. All they know is that they live offshore. When the salmon, when the bait appears, they move back in closer. We know that they chase the bait, that they follow the bait, they have to eat. They don't know exactly how far out they go because they have no way of really going out and tagging. They do know that the king salmon will live in deeper water than what silver salmon will. And they do not normally cohabitate. They live in their own schools. When we find them on bait, when we fish for them, we will find them cohabitating because they're chasing school, bait school. But when they are in the natural areas offshore, they don't both frequent the same spots. Silver salmon live higher in the stratum. King salmon live deeper. Normal king salmon depths are from 50 down to 300 feet deep. Is their normal water depths that they forage in. Where silver salmon forage higher. They normally will 40 to 50 feet is maximum that you'll find a silver salmon, unless they're on chase and bait. The silver salmon and the king salmon will just lump together and just say we're salmon fishing. If you want to know how to identify the two species, there's two very marked ways of identifying a king or a silver. Number one, if you open the mouth, the gum line of a silver salmon is white, where the teeth are embedded into the gum. The gums are white. A king salmon is black. That's the most deadly way of identifying the two species. If you look at the side of a silver salmon and a king, they are spotted. They have black spots on the body. Silver salmon, the black spots run the length of the body up to the upper lobe of the tail only. On a king salmon, the black spots will go down the length of the top of the body and it will be on both lobes of the tail. It'll be loaded with black spots. And that's the two. There's other ways, but that's the two most distinct ways of identifying them. The best, easiest way is to open it, look at its chops. And the gums will be white on a king salmon, or on a silver salmon, and the gums will be black where the teeth are embedded in the gums. They'll be black on a king. So that's the easiest way. But we're going to talk, lump them together for time-wise. Nobody really goes fishing for one species or the other anyway. We go fishing for salmon, and so we'll go for both species. The salmon migration, as we call it, starts at about point conception. These salmon will go beyond that. They may have found them off Baja, but in numbers enough to be a fishable market, it starts point conception. In the spring, early spring, that's where the anchovies are. Southern California first. The anchovies will start up and the squid will start working up the coast. And that's the two main diet of the bulk of these salmon is anchovies and squid. They will start moving up the coast. They will follow the bait. When they arrive in our area, it depends on a lot. Like this year, we got water temperatures are way up, so this is an unpredictable year. On a normal year, they will start moving up in, so probably as early as April, in numbers, that you'll start finding salmon off Monterey. Now, this is as far as we fish, because it's as far as we can launch a boat. If we're going to go below Monterey, we're going to have to go clear down to San Simeon and fish out Point Conception. So we don't worry about that. We worry about what arrives up here. And March and April, we will start seeing some fish come up the coast, the bait. As the bait works its way up, it's not in large numbers yet. There's bait out there. There's some fish out there. But it's small numbers. It worked their way up from Monterey, Half Moon Bay. We see some fish with small numbers. All of them fish that are south of Pedro Point are migratory fish, all of them. They've all been to sea and they have no natural bait. In Monterey, there's no natural bait in Half Moon Bay, with the exception of a few rockfish that they'll feed on, so they're not going to stay there for that. They're going to go south. Now, if you get Pedro Point to Point Reyes, which everybody knows is the Gulf of the Farallones, Gulf of the Farallones is the most nutrient-rich waters off of the Pacific coast. You have to get into Baja, California to find better water, nutrient-wise. You have to get into the cup in Baja, California to find what we have right here in the Gulf of the Farallones. We have a natural salmon fishery all year in the Gulf of the Farallones. The fish are there all year. Unlike Monterey, unlike Half Moon Bay, because there is no natural food. But here we have the main diet, krill shrimp, in this fishery in the Gulf of the Farallones. Some of the salmon that come down out of the rivers will live there 2 to 3 years right in the Gulf of the Farallones. They'll never leave that. They don't have to. They got everything there they need. They got all the bait, the food, everything is there. But anybody that's fished that knows that, with exception of the spring run, which I'll mention in a minute, when you go fishing, the party boats love it. They're all 2 to 3 year fish in the spring. 6 pound fish. You don't find any big fish in that, but that's a natural area. You could fish that. If the season was open, you could fish it all year. There'd be fish in there. You could find it. But what makes that better is this migration coming up later. So we can follow the fish up now. The fish will show at Monterey. The fish that are coming up Monterey and migrating up are coming up to get into the Delta system to spawn now. That's the reason they're migrating up. These fish in the spring, as they come up, are 2, 3, and 4 year fish that are coming up. So schooled up, coming up together. As they move up from starting at Monterey in, we'll take March as a starter, they will feed and gorge on shrimp, on anchovy, and squid. As they come up, they move up into the krill beds, and they will eat a lot of krill also. But their main diet is going to be anchovy and squid. Anchovy and squid is nothing but protein, solid protein. These fish that come up are only a 2, 3, or 4 year fish. When we get them in Monterey, we get a lot of 12 to 15 pound fish down there early in the season. Witnessed the last few years we fished there. You go down there and you get nice quality fish early. Now that same fish, by the time he gorges from Monterey, gets around and comes up to the gate, and when he gets ready to move into the gate, in starting in September, they will start schooling to come up the river, they will gain 2 pounds a month. So if you've got a fish down there that's the 12-pound fish, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, is 6 months that fish has gained 12 pounds while we're waiting for him to move up here. So now that 12-pound fish is a 24-pounder. That's the reason we get, as sport fishermen, we get the larger fish at the gate later in the season because they have gorged on all this protein. And that's what they're doing. They're gorging on the protein to get up the energy to go up the river. And they've gained, from the time we first intercept them in the south, up here, they've gained 12 pounds. The fish that we get at Monterey and Half Moon Bay, as they move up, depending on, as all of you know, there's on again, off again right now, these fish are hanging out there. What they're doing is chasing bait. That's all they are, is a feeding machine right now. They got two things on their mind, eating and building up their bodies and going up the river for that one-time screw so they can die. And that's all. They're hanging out, they're chasing that bait. So that's all they've got to do is stay on that bait out there. They're going up and down, up and down. The currents, as the current goes, the warm water moves out, and the cool water comes behind it, the bait comes in. The fish will chase the bait in. So you have to get out and find the fish, find the bait. But what you have to bear in mind is that that's what they're doing. They're moving slowly up the coast, and they're going to be where the bait is at. So you got to think like a fish and think, where is the bait going to be, and that's where I'm going to go fish. If you want to fish early, like I said in the start, the Gulf of the Farallones is a natural fish bowl out there. The fish will never leave there. A lot of them, those spawners will come down, they'll stay right in the Gulf of the Farallones. And they'll live out there 4 years and head back up the river. But what you're going to get there is the smaller fish early in the season. Once they start getting big, they're going to be big as the other fish are coming up. They group together and go up the river. So the fish that are coming up to spawn are looking for bait. Now, the anchovies are coming from the south. Squid lives all the way up and down the coast. But the anchovies really don't live in this area, because the water gets too cool here in the wintertime. So the anchovies move south to the warmer water, and it'll come up. And what brings the anchovies up is plankton. In the spring, sometimes in March, April, it's unpredictable, we get what is called an upwelling. Once we get strong northerly winds, it turns the ocean completely over. Brings the bottom to the top. The bottom is nutrient rich. It brings that to the top, and that's when your anchovies will start showing, once you get an upwell. This is a phenomenon on our whole coast. They have the anchovies now will hang out for all this nutrients, and they're being chased by the salmon. They're being chased by the salmon into the beach. That's the reason we find them at Martin's Beach. If you get enough salmon behind a school of anchovies, they're going to push them right in there. And you've all seen their meters go black at Martin's Beach or any of the beaches down the coast, because that's a pocket. And the fish can circle and push all that up in there. Finding the salmon could be a little different story. We'll try and touch on that in a little bit, but that's what's happening. The fish are pushing the bait in there. This year being an off year with the warm water, salmon have to have 57 degrees or lower to really be in their own good habitat. Anything above that is too warm. So 57 degrees or cooler, and this year we're seeing high temperatures offshore. We're seeing some mighty warm surface temperatures out there. So it's really anybody's guess where you're going to find the fish, but if I was to go fishing tomorrow, I would be in deeper water looking deeper for the big fish instead of being up in the shallow water. I believe the big fish are still in the deeper water where they feel comfortable, and there's still bait out there. But these fish now, in the fall, we fish Monterey, we fish Half Moon Bay, we pump in the gate, we fish in the gate. The fish are now 12 pounds or so bigger than they started out, and we start seeing a number of 24, 28, 30-pound fish out here. Because the four-year fish can bulk up. We see them. Gene, I think, got a 42-pounder. Eddie's got a 5-pounder out there, whatever. We used to see 55-pounders, quite common. But we probably won't see that phenomenon again around here. But we used to see a lot of big salmon. Every year, the party boats would be weighing in probably 15 to 20 over 50 pounds. Now, I haven't heard of one for a number of years over 50 pounds here. But these fish are bulking up, they're going back up the river and start the spawning cycle again. Now, just to touch a little bit on the spawning. it would be great if they could do this, but they can't anymore. We've got everybody tugging at everybody else's projects. Somebody's lock is going off. We got everybody tugging at everybody else's project here. We've got a water loss, we've got pollution, we've got a lot of things causing it. The fish.
Time's up.
Yeah, time's up. The fish that are going up to spawn, are intercepted at the hatcheries, as we probably all know. Most of them intercepted at the hatcheries now. Thankfully, they've got this down to a pretty good science. They can milk the fish, cut the female open, put the eggs in a bucket, milk the male, and one male can fertilize a whole bucket of eggs. From one female, the average is about 2,500 eggs, plus or minus. But one female, in fact, the Sacramento salmon is the highest producer of all the coastal salmon, and they will go as high as 6,000 eggs. But the average for the whole coast, Smith, Plymouth, and all of them, is about 2,500 eggs. 3,000 eggs. But one male, they just squeeze him out and fertilize these eggs. They save this, that way they can use the salmon. They can use both the male and the female. They use them in hospitals. Give them to hospitals, children's homes, and stuff. So they don't go to waste. They don't just die and let the buzzards get them. But there's a problem with that. What is happening is, we're seeing less and less fish returning to the natural spawning grounds up there because they started this a number of years ago of artificially spawning these fish. And what's happening is, if you take in a natural spawn, let's take a number of 1,000 females made it up and she spawned, and for every female, there was a male that would fertilize these eggs. The escapement off them eggs, by the time they get back, may only be 100 fingerlings from that female. But then that 100 comes back down, and they go to the ocean and survive. But what's happening, we are intercepting them. So we're taking one female, and we're stripping her. We're taking one male and we're fertilizing maybe for 5 or 6 buckets of eggs from the females. So now we got one male fertilizing 5 females in these buckets. We only have to have about 30 females to make up for this 1,000 because the survival rate is almost 100%. Because we take them eggs, we put them in incubators, and we incubate them, and we put them in pens and we hand feed them, the survival rate is almost 100% because they have no predators in there to get rid of them until after they're turned loose. So the survival rate from them, we have now 30 females and 5 males doing the same thing that 1,000 males and 1,000 females were doing. Now, them fingerlings go back to the ocean, they come up next year, and they take another 30. Well, these 30 that they're taking now are brothers and sisters, mothers and fathers. Where you had 1,000 mothers and fathers before, now you've only got 30. So when these fingerlings come back up, there's mothers and sisters, fathers and sons, and aunts and uncles in this pot. Now we do the same thing. We take 30, we milk them with 5 males. Next year, the same thing happens. What are we doing? We're lowering the strength of these fish. These fish are becoming so weak because we've been spawning them, they can't make it back up the river if they had a place to go because they're too weak to go now. They've lost it. Genetically, they're declining. They don't have the good habitat to go through, and they couldn't survive anymore because we've done this to ourselves by spawning. They didn't really think about this in the beginning, I guess, but as evolution has come about, this is what's happening. Salmon today are not fighters. They have seen them. The people that were lucky enough 25 years ago to go to Fulton or any of the dams up the river and watch these fish go up a fish ladder. I mean, they'll jump and they'll bridge a fish ladder against a hell of a current coming down, and they'll go 40, 50 feet flying through the air. Now, they're swimming around in circles. They're just too damn weak. They can't make it up these fish ladders. They have to be hand-carried into a spawning pool and spawn. The genes have been interfed too much or interbred. So that is one of the problems that we're facing. The lumber companies, of course, they're clear-cutting. The lumber companies is probably worse than what the water conservation is, but they clear-cut. So what happens? They go up, they clear-cut land. As soon as we get a little rain, the rain washes the silt into the stream beds. The stream beds, salmon have to have gravel to spawn in. And they have to have pools in these stream beds to spawn in for the cool water. But what is happening is the silt is washing in, filling the stream bed level. There is no more pools, there is no more gravel, no place for them to spawn if they get there. So the few that they see going up to spawn, they're finding them just swimming around dying because there's no place for them. They know what they need and they can't find it. There's nothing up there for them. So that by clear-cutting the edges, there's no more shade, the water temperature's raised, they've got the pools, there's no more dips in the bottom, it's all... The lumber company is probably just as, if not more, responsible than right now than what water is. Another thing, anybody has ever been up any gold dredgers working in the mountains? The gold dredgers, they have absolutely no care. They sit there and pump this shit all over the place and eating up the stream bed. Same way. We know that water is a problem when the fish are coming back down. We know that. And we have to have the water, but we can't blame it all on water. It's a tenfold project, a tenfold problem, not just one problem. We can blame it, point the finger, but if we don't eventually somehow get all of them to work together, we're not going to have the species. But the water, granted, is a problem, but it's not the only problem. I've heard a lot of people say, well, you know, water, water, water. There's other problems besides that. So, anyhow, these fish go up and spawn either natural or artificially, and they come back down and start this life cycle again. We've kind of followed them up. We know the bait's out there, but they're feeding on. If we're going to go fishing for them, then where do we go? How do we look? What do we find? You know, where do we go looking for fish? We can go fishing, like I say. The furthest launching ramp is going to be Monterey. You can fish Monterey. You can fish from big round the corner at Big Sur, or you can come up the coast and fish out of the gate and fish as far as Point Reyes. I think all of us in this club has fished just about that whole area. You have to kind of think, well, what quality do I want? We're moochers now. We're not going to even talk about trolling. We're going to talk about mooching because that's what we've all turned to is mooching. Gene will explain what mooching is for those that are new at it. But that is the type of fishing we're going to do. In order to mooch, we have to find the fish. If you're trolling, you can run all over the ocean with a trolling boat. In one day, you can cover a lot of territory. But if we're going to mooch, we have to find the fish. So how's the best way? How are we going to find fish? Number one, where should they be at this time of the year? That's the first thing. They're still in Monterey, Carmel, Half Moon Bay, that way, Pedro Point, where should they be at this time of the year? What's the water conditions? What's the reports we're hearing? Okay, we get an idea by talking, listening, get the reports from the party boats, other fishermen, what area are these fish? If we were party boat skippers, we'd know because we're out there every day, but we're not. We have to go out on weekends, so we got to have an idea of which direction to go. Well, I hear there's a run at Half Moon Bay. Okay, we're going to go to Half Moon Bay and go fishing tomorrow morning. We get there, what do? We ask Bob on the fishing machine where to go fishing. That's one way. But the best thing to do is find out the area that they've been getting it and go find our own fish. That's half the challenge, is finding the fish. It's easy to go follow somebody else, but it's much more fun and more rewarding if you can set out in the morning and go fishing and bring back limits of fish and say, I caught them. I didn't go follow somebody else to catch these fish. I went out and found them myself. So if you know the area that the fish are hanging out, and if they were getting them at Martin's Beach, that means there's bait all up and down that area there. Go find them. You don't have to go follow somebody else. When you get out there to an area, if you find out what area the fish are in, if they're in Monterey or if they're in Half Moon Bay, once you find the area, then we have to locate them. Everybody has their own preference. If they want to fish in shallow water or if they want to fish in a little deeper water, everybody has their own ideas. Find the bait. Today, mooching is popular only one reason. That is because we have electronics. We can find bait today. 15 years ago, 10 years ago, we couldn't find bait. We had a flasher on a boat that you'd be able to find the bottom, maybe. If you had a good flasher, you'd be able to read a bottom. But you couldn't find the bait. I've been out with guys who said, oh yeah, man, there's a ball of bait. Bullshit. They didn't know if they had the game cranked up and had static in it, or if they had bait down there. They didn't know what they were looking at, but it sounded good. Then came the graphs. The graphs were better. The graphs have pretty close to what a scope is today. So when they come in with the graphs about 10 years ago, they had started with the heat-sensitive paper, and was able to get a graph that worked reliably. Then you could start locating the bait. And then from there, they started mooching in the last 4 or 5 years, 6 years, and it's because they can find these concentrations of bait. If you're mooching, you're going to cover such a small area that you have to locate where these fish should be on the bait. So if you locate the bait, there should be fish in that area. The bait, it doesn't matter if you're fishing on anchovies or squid, you're still going to use the same general rigging, you're going to use the same general bait. You can do, Gene will talk a little bit about the difference that you can use in jig and so forth for squid and anchovy, but we're going to use anchovies for bait. We find the area that the fish should be in, the next thing you have to find is the depth that these fish are swimming. These fish are no different out there than they are in a pond. There's stratas of nutrients, the water temperature, that's where the bait's going to be, is in these stratas of temperature. And when you find the bait, that's the area that the fish should be in under that bait. So that's the next thing to look for, is trying to find the depth of the bait. If it's all surface bait, then you have to experiment, which now we're limited to one rod, I guess. It's going to be tough to do a whole lot of experimenting, but spread your tackle out until you find a fish, hopefully, in this. Now, if you don't find fish in this first ball of bait you found, or the first area of bait, watch. Watch for birds. That's your first giveaway. If you see birds working, it's a clue that there's fish working under the bait, pushing the bait to the surface. If you get out and you see mirrors sitting on the water, you'll almost always find bait under them mirrors. There's almost always a ball of bait. But if the mirrors are just sitting there, not active, they're probably full, And but they're hanging around that bait until they get hungry again. So they're going to follow that bait. But that doesn't mean there's any fish under it. Because if there's fish under that bait feeding, it's going to push the bait to the surface. The bait's going to come up, and that means the fish are working and pushing it up. When the fish push the bait up, that's when you'll see pelicans and the rest of them diving on the bait. It's not a nothing 100% in this business, but 99% of the time, if you see birds diving, that means there's some kind of fish working under it. It doesn't have to be salmon. It can be other fish, too. Gene got in a bunch of mackerel out there pushing fish up the other day. And this can happen. Mackerel can do the same thing. Anything that's feeding is going to push the fish up. But look for bird action and look for birds diving. If the birds are diving, good chances there's fish under it pushing it up. When you do come into a ball of bait, or if you see birds working and you figure it's a ball of bait, don't run into the middle of the bait and drop and say, man, I'm on top of them. Work on the perimeter of it and try to keep the bait corralled. The bait's going to be moving, so you want to try to keep the bait inside the boat corral and drift through it, come back and drift on the edges of it. Don't try to bust it up. If you see birds working, there's nothing more discouraging than to go out and find a ball of bait, start working the ball of bait, and have some other boat see you hooked up, and he comes like a mad dog running right through the ball of bait and drops right in the middle of it. Now he's got the bait scattered and pushed down. So if you see a nice ball of bait, bird working, work the perimeters of the bait. Stay on the outside of it. If you see other boats working, try to set your drift so you'll drift on the edge of the bait, not through it. Work on the edges of it. Or if you see boats working, try to set up a drift so you drift towards their boat. Don't run right in and drop on top of them. Because the worst thing you can do is to drive this bait back down. Because once it gets driven down, it's going to scatter. The salmon or whatever's pushing it up is going to attack it and scatter. So the salmon are around it. They've already corralled it for you. They've got it corralled and they've got it pushed up. Now, how did they corral it? There's the little fish are the scouts. They're the ones that have corralled this. They're active. These little devils are, man, they're all gung-ho, man. They're going to go. And they work this fish, and they'll corral it. And they'll push it up. They'll surround it. Then the big fish are smart. They'll work under it. The big fish are always hanging out deeper than the little fish are. I say always like that was an absolute. It's not an absolute. I've caught fish on top of the water, but the bulk of them are under it, the big fish. So when you get in on this perimeter of this bait, the little fish are up there attacking it. A salmon one-on-one with an anchovy would never catch the anchovy. It's impossible. They know that. They have to get in and attack a ball of anchovies, wound it, let it go die wound or wounded and start down to die, and then grab it. That's the only way they can do it. One-on-one, a salmon doesn't have a chance to catch an anchovy. He's too fast, he's too slick. So when they get into a big, surround the bait, they get it followed up, the little ones will go in there and they'll charge it and they'll attack it and they'll do it with their mouths open, hitting them, trying, they'll grab at anything. But they're really not getting that much in them to eat. They're breaking up this bait, killing it, wounding it, and as it flutters down, these big devils are down there just waiting for it. They're catching this shit coming down. That's what they're feeding on. The bait is lowers in the bottom of this ball. So what you want to do, if you're satisfied with the smaller surface fish, put some high lines, and then get a couple of lines. If you got enough guys on the boat, not pulling one rod, get some baits down below. Always have a boat. I never fish without a bait on the bottom. I don't care if I'm in 300 feet of water. I want one of my baits 250 feet down there. Because that's where the big fish are going to be. I'll keep one of my other 12 up high. But I always fish. I always fish with at least one rod deep. I get rockfish, and I think we all have went over reefs and picked up rockfish and everything in our deep rods. But we know that there's the big fish are going to be under this. Now, while we're drifting, we're going to be catching the littler fish, and we're going to get a mix of smaller, bigger fish up inside. But the bulk of the big fish are going to be under that school. Sometimes you can't fish it. Sometimes you can't get through these other fish to get to it, too. But try to get a line down deep. That's where the fish, that's where the big fish are going to be. Georgie.
Take a break.
Take a break? Am I wound up too much? Okay.
No, let's do a break.
Okay. Questions up so far what we've kind of talked about. Ken?
You speak of these big fish being underneath the bait and all that, and just recently being out in Captain Bay or Monterey or wherever, we've been catching these smaller fish. These smaller fish, are these ones that are just one-year-old fish that are just hanging around, or are they three or four-year-old?
Two-year. They would be 2 and 3. Year fish.
The smaller shakers type?
Yeah. Most salmon will remain in the river system for the first year. Then he will come down, whether it be artificially spawned or naturally spawned, he will come down. He goes out and he's a second year fish. So what we're seeing is second year fish intermingled with the third and fourth year fish. They know that these fish, they don't go out and say, all the two-year-old fish over here, all the one-year-old fish over here, and all the 3 years over there, you know, in their own area. They school together.
Right.
They will go out and they'll intermingle. And they will work together. So what we're seeing in these schools is 2, 3, 4, and when you get a 55-pounder, that's naturally a fish that he's not going back up the river to die. He's going to die on your hook, maybe. But that could be a 5, 6-year-old fish. He doesn't, they don't all go back up. That's how he got that big. He decided he wasn't going to go up there and die. It wasn't worth dying for. So he doesn't, so he's out there with these
San Francisco fish, right?
Yeah, he's out there with these other fish. But you'll see 2, 3, 4, the bulk of the fish, 2, 3, and 4-year-old fish.
How long can you stay with the bait? If you were all the bait, and you're looking up, how long can you stay before you decide to leave a little more bait?
That's a good question because, you know, luck is 90% of this. The other 10%, change your method. If you're still not looking up, then I would say that the fish are either not in that ball of bait or they're not feeding at that time. Yeah. Ronnie's famous saying is we're going through a tide change. Well, they do feed by tides. They have to have current movement, not have to have, but current movement for two reasons. It's easier for them to feed in a moving current because they can attack against it, or it will move your boat. So if you're in a dead still, you're fishing onto the spot down here. So if the conditions are right, if you're making a good drift, you've still got good bait, that would be your own determination of whether you want to sit and wait that out or go look. But if you have a Loran, by all means, punch that area back in so you can get back in that area if it doesn't, something happen someplace else. But I would, if it was me, I would go move and look. I would go, if I was on Martin's Beach and I was fishing 60, 70 feet of water and I was on good bait and I wasn't getting any fish, I'm going deeper. First thing I'm going to do, I'm going to work outside of that school. For the simple reason, how did that bait get there? The fish didn't come off the bank and push it down there. They came from the deep water and pushed it in. So where are the fish at? They're behind it. Go look for them behind the fish in deeper water.
Jim, can I add something to that? Last year, we were in Half Moon Bay, and in the morning we were out there, I'd say south of a little bit south of S1, and maybe out in about 120 feet of water. And we got into a little bite first thing in the morning, and it just shut off. And we got impatient, we all left, and we went north. Well, there was nothing north either. That afternoon, Ronnie came back in, and he went right back to where we started, and he started hammering them. He called us in, and we actually limited out that day just by going back the woods.
They were there, they just stopped eating.
They just went off the bike.
Yeah, people go off the bike, back on the bike just as quick as they go off. But, you know, that doesn't mean you have to sit there and wait for them on that one ball. Go look. My, like I say, my idea is work deeper, because that's where them fish came from, was the deeper water and pushed it into the shore.
The small fish school the bait and they're wounding the anchovies.
Right.
For the squid, and they're dropping down. The bigger fish are underneath just waiting for these to come down, and those are the fish that, if you fish deeper, are the ones that we are catching, the bigger, the quality fish. Okay? Now, how are all the fish schooling together? 30 pounders, 20 pounders, 5 pounders, 4 pounders, are they all schooling together? Do they school together?
Yeah, they all swim together. They intermingle, they cohabitate, yeah.
Okay, so then when we're saying these guys, say Bobby, fishing machine, we're catching schoolie fish, okay? So we're out there and we go in to where they're catching those schoolies. So we stay on the outside since we are, they're trolling, we're mooching. So we should stay on the outside of the bait and drop our lines deeper in the water to catch the bigger fish. Correct?
Correct. But the guy that's trolling, remember, he's trolling in the bait. Granted, if you got down rivers, you can get down deep and troll deeper. But most of these guys are trolling on the top 30, 40, 50 feet of water.
Okay.
Okay, where are they trolling? They're trolling through these schoolies. So the bait that he has got that he's trolling is moving just like the anchovies in that school. That the bait that he's trolling is moving. Now, the little fish that he gets are attacking his bait because they are in there trying to break up, and that bait that he's trolling through that school is just another part of that school. That's the reason the party boats just love these school fish, because they go after the numbers. They don't care about quality. All they care about is the numbers on their boats. And they will go out there, and you'll hear limits up to 25 pounds. Okay, they got one 25 pounder, and they got 31 6 or 8 pounders, school fish. Because they're trolling their lines with 3 pound lead behind a boat, and the deepest they're going to be able to get down is going to be 25 feet. By the time they get scope out on that line, they're 25 feet is all. They might have 100 feet of line out, but they're still throwing 25 feet. So they're strolling through the bait where these fish are going.
I have one other question, Gil. This last weekend, we opened up our fish, and the majority of all the fish had squid in them. We strictly fish with anchovies. Now, why, if they're full of squid, are they eating on the anchovies? Why are they biting on the anchovies?
Well, I don't believe a fish is full, number one. A fish is still going to feed. If he's in there feeding, that's all he is a feeding machine. He's only there with that in mind. I don't believe he's smart enough to know his stomach is full. We lay it on that. We say, oh, hell, they're gorged. You know, all this bait, they're gorged. They're not going to feed. You go out there and catch them where they didn't bite for 4 hours and catch a fish, he won't have nothing in his stomach. Why didn't he feed? It wasn't because he was gorged. So I don't believe this is a cop-out on our part. We like to make excuses as fishermen. Why we're not catching fish, we come up with all these excuses. I don't believe that fish knows he's gorged. If he is gorged with anchovy or with shrimp, and you're in a... if you stick an anchovy down there, or if he's gorged on squid, and you stick an anchovy down there, that's still a natural bait to him, and he's still going to attack it. If it's an easy prey, such as a mooching rig is, he still is going to attack it, because it looks like a wounded fish, that's easy. Now, you got to realize squid are slower. They can feed on squid one-on-one. They don't do it. They feed in schools of squid, but an anchovy or a salmon can attack squid one-on-one. The odds of catching it, outmaneuvering it, is very poor, but they don't normally do that. They do the same thing in schools of squid that they do in anchovies. They go in there and break it up and wound them. But squid are more passive. They're not as fast swimming as what an anchovy is. But they feed on both. Both being natural to them in that area.
It doesn't matter if the salmon are feeding on krill, squid, anchovies, or even a little bokkasi. You caught salmon with the little teeny bokkasi. It doesn't matter. You stick an anchovy down there, they're going to take it. And you don't want to fish with a, you know, if they're taking a little bokkasi, you don't want to fish with the 8-inch anchovy. You want to fish with the smaller baits. They'll take it. They don't discriminate. So that's all we're feeding on is krill today. That was it, then you wouldn't catch any. And the bigger fish, what Gil's saying is, a bigger fish is not going to expend the energy to try to compete with these 4 to 12 pound fish, because they can't. They're not fast enough. These fish are diving, darting through there, so their only chance of really getting any good amount of bait is when they're going through, these fish are killing them. Tons of anchovies, wounding them, and they're just falling down. And that's why the theory is, if you want a bigger fish, drop your line down. If you're going down 30, go down 60. If you're fishing 80 foot of water, go down 60 feet. Go down that 7, doesn't make any difference.
Yeah, bear in mind that these fish only have two purposes in life. Mm-hmm. That's to eat and go up there and reproduce. That's the only two purposes they have in life. They don't take a day off and go fishing like we do. They don't know any better. They only are going to eat to survive so that they can make it back up the river to spawn, to perpetuate the species. That's all they know in life. And so when they're eating, when they're out there, they have to get all this protein in them. Otherwise, they can't make it up the river. They're foraging on it. And if you take a salmon, say you go to Monterey early in the season and catch a salmon, you put it in a frying pan and fry it, you have to add some Pam or something to it. It'll stick. You take a salmon and catch it in Half Moon Bay, or if you catch a salmon in the Gate, come September, you got to drain some of the oil off that pan, because he is so gorged with protein. I think we have one over. Andy?
Why is it such, when you're fishing with Rob or somebody, you're always competing against each other, and so then, and there's days you can run on a Saturday, and you can, wait, and they'll take that and show you, damn, he hooked himself, he kamikaze did. But then you can be out there the next day on a Sunday, and all day long, they'll just pick at us. You're trying to catch it because you're just so frustrated, and you can't, not let them take it. No, but even if they are, and you just sit there and wait, and then eventually scrape it and leave. Hit it once or twice and leave, but never actually take it. Here's the point where you get frustrated. But then I've also gone to the singles and ran a single through a male with a tiny hook and buried it inside so it couldn't see it. And then eventually he'd swallow that one because he never felt the hook.
I think Gene will get into that a little later, how we're baiting for him, the difference and the purpose of the difference. But as far as that, if we knew why they would bite one day and not the next, we'd only go that one day. We wouldn't go the next. So I think, there's so much of this, it's not a science. It's only theory. And all we can do is take what we have learned in the past, we've talked to people, we've listened to people, and you try to put this together and make some sense out of it. You can't, there is no absolute in fishing of any kind. You got, it goes back to the 90% luck, 10% skill, and then the 10% skill is only what we've acquired from other people and been able to put together and hope we come up with a few answers. Nobody's got all the answers. Why they do that, we don't know, but we have some ideas to overcome it on how to cheat a little bit, so we put some of that in our favor, which Gene will get into.
One thing to remember, if a fish knew what this was, there was no way he'd buy it.
That's right.
Yeah, well, I'm sure everybody that's sitting in this room with one kind or another caught fish, has had two or three of these in them. So if they're that smart that they know what this is, and there ain't nobody in this room going to go out and catch a fish.
Yeah, we had another.
Yeah, I think Gino asked my question later, so I'll go.
Yeah,
okay. The thing was to get the wooden ones, right? When you got a piece of bait that's torn up a little bit, you throw it away, you put a good one down there.
You don't need to.
Yeah, I know, but it was,
we do it.
You would throw it on a cripple.
Right. We do it for a number of reasons. We do it out of frustration, because we're not getting bites. We got to reel in all our weights and change them. You know, years ago, I fished for salmon trolling. I've worked on commercial boats. I've fished party boats, fished bomb boats for years and years and years, trapped salmon trolling. If a bait came in, it had a tooth mark in it, and you put that back out, they'd think he was crazy. The fish knows that bait's been hit. He ain't gonna go bite that bait again. Oil. If you had diesel oil on your hands or anything, you didn't dare touch bait. You went, got sanitized. Now what do? We spray WD oil, WD-40 on them. We dip them in bilge oil. We do anything to try to entice bait. All that shit. All that theories, the old theories have gone out the window. They've learned a whole lot. I've taken baits and put down where I've made a move, and I want to get a bait back in the water, and I've had baits that look like they low respected fish would even touch it. And you get that one down, you'll be able to bait up another one, you get a hit on that bait. And it was a piece of shit when you put it down there. So the bait does not have to be perfect. I believe bait has to be fresh. I believe that the scent of sour bait will turn the fish off. I believe it has to be fresh. The fresher, the better. But other than that, the looks of that bait, it has to be in an area so it'll perform right for you, which Gene will show you. But as far as being scratched up and raked up, hell, they cut heads off of herring to make a plug bait. So I don't believe the condition of the bait is really that important today. It's the freshness of the bait. I believe fish, in fact, we know that they smell with their lateral lines. They sense bait, and they know this, and they can sense rotten bait, old bait, stale bait.
And not when you're not hooking.
Any other, yeah?
You're talking about a lot of the Sacramento River fish that go south and live their lives and then come back up. Is there a percentage of those fish that go north and live their lives and then come down?
Yeah, they do intermingle. Okay, that's a good question. When they were going through this last river rule they had with the federal and state over the migration of these fish, believe it or not, our fishery in what they consider the Sacramento Delta fish, this area is not in trouble at this time. There's an abundance of fish. We may not know that on the days we go fishing. We might think there ain't nothing left. But this fishery is healthy. What they are trying to do is reclaim the Klamath River Basin, which is from Bodega Bay north. That is where they're in trouble. But they have caught Klamath River fish in Half Moon Bay. And they have caught Delta fish out of the Sacramento. They go out, and that's why I said at the start of this, they're not 100% sure where these fish go. They don't know how many turn left or how many turn right or how many go straight out. They really don't know at this point. But they probably aren't really concerned that much. They're concerned about those that come back in. That's the one they're concerned with, is what we're seeing return. But they do, some go north, some of the Klamath fish. When we say Klamath, we don't only mean Klamath River. We're talking Smith and the rest of the rivers up there. Out of Oregon also. All these fish cohabitate up there. And some of our fish go north and some of their fish come south. So they do intermingle. But the fish that are coming back in are coming, they all come back to the same place that they were originally spawned. So the fish that are coming back in, if they went north, they're going to come back in the gate. But the abundance of our fish come from the south. They know that. But that doesn't mean it's an absolute. There is fish that went north that come back from the north.
The inbreeding, and you say the negative winter strain,
mm-hmm.
how come they don't switch eggs of like out of Washington or a different tributary so they wouldn't have the same stream coming back all the time?
I don't know. I could rationalize why it wouldn't work, because they're spawning, where they're spawned is where they're going to come back.
Now, they can ship eggs.
Yeah, I don't know what the life would be. You know, I'm sure that's been tried, and it hasn't been done.
Well, an egg from a clamate, that fish after hatch, he'd be looking for the water from the clamate.
Yeah. Right. So they can ship eggs.
So he'd be lost.
Well, they would have to ship. What they would have to ship, see? That egg, when that fish is in the egg, the egg, from that point on, from the time of the point, it doesn't have to wait until he's already a smolt. The time he's in that egg, he knows, it starts in him, that's where he has to go back to. When he's an egg, he knows already, that's where he's going to have to come back to when he grows up. They would have to capture the fish. And I'm not even sure that would work, because even to capture the fish, the eggs and the fish have already sensed that water, so I'm not sure that would work. I'm not that learned it on the scientific end of it, but I do know that the fish will return. Talk about returning, I can tell a little story. I seen a very interesting piece on TV about a year ago. Some of you may have seen it, a documentary on the fish's return. And what they were trying to do is figure out how they were finding their way back. And they didn't know whether it was done through water temperatures, water smell, magnetic. They didn't know. They still don't know, in fact. But this documentary was showing there was there was a reservoir that they had dammed, and there was a hatchery there. They were capturing the fish. The fish that were going up, they had built a power station. The fish were going up and getting chewed up in this power station. So what they did, they took water from the reservoir, they put it into another creek and bypassed this power station and come back into the main river over here, thinking the fish would come up, smell that water from that reservoir, and go back up. Next year, no fish showed up. All the fish is over here chewed up the turbines again. They couldn't figure this out. Well, somebody got smart and figured there was a creek that came into that river. And this creek had no headwater. It was only creek out of drainage ditches and just a little bit of runoff that was feeding into this, below this reservoir. But it was also feeding below where they tapped it. And there was enough water in that creek, even though it had no tributaries, it was just a little irrigation creek, that was upsetting the balance of that whole river enough that these fish would not turn over here. They took that creek and turned it in, piped it in, flooded it, all the river went up, all the fish went up that river, just that little creek. So these fish, something in their senses is what brings them back, and I don't know that you could transfer from one to the other. But
we're talking about those silvers that showed up down there last year, and everybody said they were Oregon fish that were showing up. Do they go back? You think they go back up to Oregon then, to the silvers?
If they were Oregon fish, they went back to Oregon.
Maybe they went back.
I'll guarantee you, if they were Oregon fish, they went back to Oregon. I wouldn't guarantee you they were Oregon fish.
Yeah, that's what everybody
said. I'll guarantee you if they were, that they went back to Oregon to spawn, yeah.
I guess I'm just glad that over in the Feather River they found them too. And I mean a lot of fishermen, the guides and everything, found that the eggs taken from those fish in that water that came from there were the best bait to use, rather than getting eggs from Sacramento River or somewhere else, or being buying them from north or whatever, in packages or what. You caught more fish on the eggs that came from the stream you're fishing.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Here in San Francisco Bay, at Chauncey Point, is a marine fishery there. And they tried to spawn a new strain of salmon there. What they did, as the fish came in the ocean, they trapped them. And they spawned them right there. And they were successful in spawning the fish. And they turned them loose there. They went back to the ocean. When they came in, they came back up the river where they originally spawned, the original parents had spawned. So, to answer your question, that probably wouldn't work. Because if they could not get them, they've tried everything in the world. See, we lose so many fish from the spawning hatcheries till they reach the gate, because they spend a year in this system. And we lose so many fish. They've tried everything in the world to get these fish somehow past all the danger points. Pumps, bass eat them. They're eaten by bass coming down. There's a lot of predators coming down. So they've tried everything. And when they spawn them over there, the smolt went out to sea, and when they came back, it passed that up and went on back up where their parents had been spawning. So that's... Georgie?
I was up in Washington a couple of years ago on vacation, and we were in northeastern Washington. And we wouldn't see a couple of hatcheries there, and there was one that really amazed me. It took the salmon five different streams and rivers to get back to where they were born. And they had to come up in a stream which was about 50 feet wide. That's all it was. Just narrow little, and there's hardly any water running through it. But they came up there and they had a fish ladder that was about this wide, maybe 2 foot wide. And they came up in there and they had millions of different sized salmon through all their ponds. They had huge ponds. This is all rainwater from the streams from the mountains that came down. Well, there was these different pools, and you go to where they were holding these salmon that were going to spawn. I was amazed. The probably the one pond was about this large for this room, and it must have had 150, 200 salmon. They were just together. They were just solid. And they were huge. They must have been 40, 50, 60 pounds. So what was so amazing, they had to go through five different waters to get back to where they spawned. It's unbelievable. And the miles was tremendous. I mean, the ocean to where we were was a tremendous amount. I don't know how many miles it was, but it was a tremendous amount of miles. And they fought their way all the way back up and came back in to that area. It was unbelievable to us. You know, we didn't think a salmon would fight that much to get back to where it was born.
It was back where it was born. And something else, they have taken these salmon, they put them in a ring, and they put this ring in north, south, east, west directions in a pen. They turned the salmon loose in it and took the water that he was spawned in and bring it out a hole over here. And that salmon, this was geographically located the way the river was laid out. So he would go, he'd go back in that water and go up. Now, they took that same ring and they turned it 180 degrees and let that water, same water, come back, and that fish would go over and he'd go north. The way he geographically had spawned. So that threw a lot of their theories out. So they really, at this point, don't know all they think they know about why these fish go back. There's still a lot they don't know about. They know that they go back here, but they still are very, it's a mysterious to everybody.
They got salmon that travel all the way from this coast up here, so all the way up to Idaho. Bay of Idaho, I know, because I've hunted there, and it used to be a big thing open bay of salmon that's still in the river. They dropped it south of the street.
Kevin?
Yeah, since these hatcheries are so successful now with their, you know, breeding of fish, is that one of the reasons that, like, now the water that they don't need them and the lumberjacks and all this stuff that we're complaining about to get our fish back, that all these politicians are figuring, well, since we can breed fish like we can do anything else anymore, just let them breed them until we run out of them, and who cares where they run up the river and breed, we'll just artificial fish,
yes,
and everything keeps coming.
Okay, the fish that are bred for us to consume are not bred that way. That's not the way they're raised. Mm-hmm. They're raised in pens. They take the small one, they got great big netted pens, humongous. And they put these fish in these pens and they hand feed them, get them nice and fat, ship them off to market. They don't go to the ocean and back anymore. They tried that. They tried it in Oregon, the lumber mills and stuff tried it, but it was too much work, too much of a waste. They found they can pen feed them, and they're doing it in Chile, they're doing it in Europe. Very successful. They're not as good to eat, but they know they can do it. And that is the reason they're not concerned with the water, because they know that they can do this. What they can do, they can keep on hand-feeding these things and making these artificial salmon that are so weak that they run up down the river. We can still catch a few. How many years that will go on, we don't know. But the ones that we are raised for consumption are pen-fed salmon. They're not raised in the river system. They're hand-stripped and pen-fed.
Fresh salmon, 365.
Yeah, I think they're going to want to close, so why don't we go ahead and do your part there, and I'll shut up.
Okay.
You got 5 minutes.
I'm sorry.
This is a basic moose rod. They'll go anywhere from 7 foot to 10 and a half. I think I'm 12 feet right now. The ones I like to use are 8, 8 and a half foot. Basically, I use 12-pound test lines. And then you use, I use a slider. Slider with a swivel, good swivel down here. Yeah, something that's good with the belt. And your bait standing down there, it gets all twisted up. You come up and your line will be all curled up. You use anywhere from 1 ounce, quarter ounce, to 8 ounce. I guess the guys use 8 ounces down in Monterey to get down that 75 feet. Preferably, I like to fish with the least amount of weight I could get away with. If I can get away with 2 ounces, that's what I'm going to fish with. That's what I feel comfortable with. That's what I get more takedowns, more hits, with the lighter weight. You can use round ball, you can use banana sinkers. Everybody's fishing with them, I'm sure. You can use from moose and rigs, you can use single hooks. I'll show you a few of the ways that most of the guys have club. Okay. I like to tie it. I do everything with the snap. Now the snap here, I'll snap a banana on, and I've got a snap to do it. If I want to change weights, I don't have to break this off, retie a banana on, and then retie my leader back on. Just put everything on loose. Use a lightweight loop at the end. And I do not like 6 and 8 foot leaders, but I like 4 foot leaders. You got 8 and a half foot rod, and you got a 6 foot leader, and the fish is sitting way out there, and you've only got a 6 foot hammer on your neck. Kind of hard to get me in. The guy who's on
the side of the screwed it all up, yeah.
This is the basic moves rig, and for Donnie Martin, that barbless.
Made special?
Yeah, these are made special for Donnie Martin. Most of the guys, they go through both gill plates. This is going to be a head down bait, I'll show you first. One goes through the gill plate, and then I'll take one. I wrap the leader around them one time, and I'll go into the belly, back by the back row hammer, then like that. You take and you put a half inch in the tail, so when the bait's dangling, you dump the tail will bend. I don't know if it makes any difference. I don't like the tail to go to the, this hook will start ripping out. And with the two the gills, you don't have to worry about the gill plates open up. If it's rough water, those gill plates, when your line comes up, they just flare out and eventually they tear. You have one side tore all the time and it'll just, I don't know, tweak. It's not too natural. You see an anchovy going through water, or if it's wounded, a gill plate will
open just a little bit, but it's not going to, both sides, it's not going to flare it out. That's a root to root head down. Dude, that's the way I hook mine. I'm sure there's other guys that hook them different. I try every way, this has been the most successful for me. Because when the salmon takes it, I don't care if they take it from the tail, they hit it from the tail, they turn around 95% of the time, because I have found better ways inside it. But they'll turn it around, and they'll take it head down. And then I've also talked to some commercial fishermen, especially when they're out the gate, not so much like Half Moon Bay and Monterey where you don't have to worry about big currents, but out the gate you'll get maybe a 3-foot swell every 11 seconds, but the current, you could have 5-6 ounces on your line still out there at 45 grand. You want to try to keep your line hooked, but out the gate just seems like you can't. So a lot of the commercial fishermen, what they do is just your basic up through the nose, and then they go around it again, and they'll back by the landing fin, and then they'll take and they'll put a little slight bend in their anchovy. They'll pull this up and bend the anchovy. So it's basically like you're trolling, because your line's, instead of being down here, your line's out on an angle. And then through the anchovy's got a slow roll. And when they go like a 5-ounce banana sinker instead of a ball. And they do it that way.
The slider do?
Yeah. Well, out the gate, from what I understand, when that current really gets going, and most of us have fished out there, when that current gets going, I don't care how nice the day it is, your line starts to, I don't care if you've got a 12-foot parachute, you're not moving nowhere, but your lines are just, they're out. I know that doesn't my boat. And this is what the commercial guys say, that the few of them I talk to, they do it for a living, they're out there day after day. When the current gets going real good, that's the way that they've been most successful doing. And the way I've been hooking up all this year and through the tail end of last season, most of you have heard about it, is needling. And needling is, there's just, most of the, 99% of the guys, they run through the back side of the eye. You run this, and you feel the backbone. And I come out about maybe a half inch before the tail. You need a single hook doing this. I prefer myself a 2-aught hook. This is my leader. I don't tie real big long leaders. You got a 2-aught hook, barbless.
Yeah, it's with your tongue.
Oh, yeah. This is the way I do out in the boat. Got a hold of the leader. And you pull the hook up so it's right in the eye. And you just push that hook in like that. Maybe half inch the tail. Then you keep these little rubber bands. They got they sell now at all the bait shops over there, Half Moon Bay. And again, the reason why I use the rubber band is I don't like those gills flaring out. Take the rubber band and just pop around there. 5%, almost 99% of the time, my bait's head down. And I don't buy bag bait. I buy tray bait. I don't care if it's red trays or green trays. You buy a bag of bait, and anybody that does a lot of fishing, you buy a bag of bait, you spend 2¼ for a bag of bait. Out of a whole bag of bait, you're lucky if you get 5 or 6 good baits. Those baits are just thrown in the bag, machine to
puts them in a bag. Half the time the heads are busted up on top, the bellies or big fat bellies, and the minute you put them in the water and the first swell you get and they go up in the air, the belly breaks. With that tray bait, you get all perfect baits, all scale in the air, everything there. Like we talked before, that doesn't mean a lot, but when you're mooching, I feel that a fish got more time. Not unless they're in a good bite. If they're in a good bite, it don't make any difference what you throw down. Like this year, it was not a good bite. You better be fishing a good bait. Nice shiny baits, bait that smell. If they don't have juice, a bait that don't have any blood or anything in it, I feel is a non-fishable bait. I don't like bait that sits out in the sun and dries out, like this thing's dried out for salmon. If the baits stay nice and warm, like with all their scales on, so when they go up through the water, they reflect. Because that's what you're basically doing. The boat's going up and down, this thing's pulling up this way, and it's floating down, and it's injured. It's going down, and that's when they pick it up. You buy your bag baits. You're going to go out there, and there's days you're going to nail them. When they're on a bite, you nail them with everything. When they're not biting, still hot, they're going to have good bait.
Gene, does anybody have an answer as far as why salmon, or why you should hook up and head down?
Because salmon, 99% of the salmon out there, I know somebody's going to say they caught one with the head the other way. Most of the time, when you cut those fish open, all their heads.
Is that the head goes down easier? Is that what it is?
Or basically, that's what it is. And that's what they do when you see that little tip. They're taking that, and it doesn't matter if you fish it head up or head down. They're tipping it, they're getting it in there, they make that short little run, they swallow it down, and then you feel the weight, and then you set the hook. Yeah, George.
I want to hit something on this bait. For the last couple of years, I was in disagreement with Eugene and Ronnie about the bait. But I learned this year that you guys were right about the bait. I caught a lot more fish this year going with the tray bait versus the bag bait, because what I noticed, most important, the tray bait is more silver. It doesn't have that orange look to it, and the bait's not beat up, the tails are not busted, they're not all scarred up. Well, a good indication was this last Sunday. Donnie and I fished together. We had three fish by 8:30 in the morning. The bite went off, no more fish, okay? We had a bunch of junk bait that day, but Ronnie gave us one good tray. Well, we went through that good tray, and we had a bunch of bag bait, and I rig up my